I'm Steph from iDriver Classic, and today I'm down at the 2024 Practical Classics Restoration Show at the NEC in Birmingham, England. And as you can probably see behind me, it feels like every single class of car is not only welcomed but celebrated. So that is massively up my street. Now in today's video, with over, well, there are hundreds of cars here, it's very difficult to show you absolutely everything and hear every single story. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna have a quick buzz round, spend a couple of minutes seeing some flashes of different cars. We're gonna meet some owners, find out some interesting stories and some interesting facts about some of the cars that are here today. And then we're gonna finish off with a few cars and then we're going to fire up the Proton and head on home. But first of all, let me show you some of my favourites that I've spotted today. With this being the Practical Classics Restoration Show, it only made sense to pick one of the Practical Classics team and get them to talk to us about their car story. And Danny is here. Danny is the editor of Practical Classics, as you may well know, because he's been on the mic for quite some time. How long is it now?
Well, I did my first feature for Practical Classics in 1999.
Ooh.
So you could say 25 years. 25 years, a quarter of a century. But I've edited it for the last 13 years. Which have gone past in a flash. It doesn't feel like that.
Now, I'm going to say two controversial things. Number one is a lot of people wouldn't consider a Marina a classic. You know that I do. And number two is people would say, why would you rescue one of these? So I'm going to put those two controversial questions to you. Why have you got a Marina and why have you chosen to rescue it? What's the story?
Okay, well, I think in terms of its place in the classic pantheon, a Morris Marina is as important as a Lamborghini Countach. And the reason for that is it's part of our social history. Just because it's not exotic and it's not expensive and it's not crafted by, you know, thousands of people handmade, just because it's a car for the people doesn't devalue it. It's as important as anything, as our Allegros, as our Cortinas. It's the people's cars for me are where it's at, because each one of these cars has got an amazing story to tell. It's not just about the metal, it's about the people. So that's why it's a classic.
And what's the story behind this one?
This one is quite an emotional one, I think. My first three cars were Marinas, so I've got a real nostalgia for them. Every time I sit in a Marina, I feel like I'm 17 again, because it's the car I passed my test in. But this one came from a reader, Carl Cranny, a reader of the magazine. He put it in his garage in 1989, having bought it new in 1971.
Really?
Yep. And he was going to restore it one day, as a lot of people say that, and it never quite happens. So one day he phoned me and said, it's been in my garage since 1989. If you put it back on the road, you can have it for nothing. So I went,
I
love that. I'm looking for a project. I've not done a Marina. A Marina is my core car.
Yeah.
So I went and collected it. And then I looked and realized it was a K-Ridge. And I thought, that's really early. Cool. Coupe, love a coupe. Took it back to the workshop and I got in touch with the Morris Marine Owners Club and ITAL Register. Great club, brilliant club. Even if you haven't got one, join it, because they're hilarious.
I think we'll have to see them later on, actually, because we'll have to go and have a look at one of their projects.
Yeah, they're doing a great stand here. Yeah. They've got a great stand. Anyway, Josh and Chris Whedon came out and they said, we think this is a really early car. And then they went through the records and they found out it was made in the second week of production.
No way.
So it's the second oldest super coupe known to the club. So that meant that the restoration was kind of turbocharged. And I've loved doing it, to be honest. It's a really simple, easy car to do. It's all the panels are available. The club support is superb. The one scary thing I had to do was this. This is a Webasto sunroof, right? When I found the car, it had a horrible kind of 1980s sunroof cut in the roof. And I thought, I can't have that. So I cut an even bigger hole in the roof. It's the scariest thing I've ever done on a car. I had to measure it. I measured it again. Then I went home and had a kip and came back in the morning and I measured it again. And that first time I put the angle grinder in, just I can feel palpitations even now. I cut a huge hole in the roof, put a Webasto sunroof because it was an option when it was new.
And did it fit?
It fits perfectly. It fits really, really well, yeah. So this is the first time this car's done a journey. The trip here was the first journey it's done on the road since 1989.
Really?
The petrol station I filled up at is the first time this car's been filled up at a petrol station since 1989.
And what did you use, E5 or E10?
Oh, I used E5, obviously. Super, super all the way. And it hasn't missed a beat. It's been brilliant. So I am very happy with this. Lime flower. It's living the dream, 1970s style.
Absolutely. Right, Danny, we'll wish you good luck with the car. Fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Have a great show.
And you. Thanks, Steph.
Martin, what on earth is going on here?
Well, this is my Mark 1 Fiesta van. And I decided to put a Z-Tech in it. I mean, it's quite a standard swap in the Fiesta scene.
Yeah.
But, yeah, a lot of hard work and... A lot of hours and sat in the garage for 12 years pretty much. Untouched.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I just bought it literally 12 years ago.
Yeah.
Put a new floor in it and then started my own business up and that had to stop. Put this on hold really because the business was taking over too much.
Yeah.
Then we had a daughter, so again, that stopped it. And then Hillary, literally in December, November at the Classic.
Yeah.
Car show, I got another Mark 1 Fiesta. She says, can you bring the van to this one? So in the last three and a half months, I've had to do all this to it and get it as you see now, pretty much. So yeah, every weekend, you know, 8 hours of Saturday, 8 hours of Sunday, Mrs. moaning.
So how do you feel now? You've got it to this point. What is the next stage? Do you feel motivated to carry on?
Yeah, I do, yeah. I mean, I'm unsure whether to paint it.
Mm-hmm.
As it is now, I could drive it to the supermarket, you know.
Maybe pop a bonnet.
Yeah, probably a bonnet. And then, yeah, I ain't got to worry about it, you know. If someone puts a trolley into it,
yeah.
it's not the end of the world, is it? You pay $5,000 paint job on it, and then you'll be like, oh, I'm going to put it anywhere and panic. And so I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do yet, but I may have tried and get 12 months with it as it is, see if I... You know,
You've got the van. How many of these vans are left? Because I don't think I've seen any.
How many are left site?
Yeah.
You know, I've looked. It says seven.
Seven.
So I don't know how true that is. But you know, I'm only going on what the internet says. So.
But even so, I would say under 100 is remarkable when you think how many would have been made by Ford back in the day. I guess because it's a vehicle which lends itself well to commercial purposes, they would have just been used, abused, and then.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, you look through the photos. I mean, you know, completely had new floors. It was rotten. You know, originally when I bought it, I thought, it looked a decent motor. But then when you start digging into it, you know, you then realise how bad it is and rotten, and so it's pretty much had new floors, new front end, and a 2 litre Z-Tech.
And if I said to you, estimate how many hours you've put into this so far, what would you say?
A lot. Well, since Christmas,
yeah.
Should we say every Saturday, Sunday, so 8 hours every Saturday, Sunday since Christmas, and then all the years before. I don't know. Hours and hours. I don't know. Just it never really. I should have made a bit more of a log about it, really. But when I first had it, you know, before I started my own business, so I'd get home from work, you know, work on it till 9 o'clock at night. Yeah. So that was, say, like, you know, half five, six until 9 o'clock, a couple of hours a night, a couple of hours a week. Then every couple of weekends, I'd say, and then I started my own business up, and then it had to just be put back away because I just couldn't, I just couldn't do both.
Well, you know what? It's a cracking bit of kit.
Thank you.
Good luck with it.
Thank
and
you.
Hopefully we'll see you at the November show.
Hopefully.
You'll be a bit further
hopefully
on.
We'll see. It may not be painted, but it may be maybe driven here properly. But yeah.
We'll come back and check.
That's it. Thank you.
Well, I tell you what, this is a little bit glamorous, isn't it? We've got a Dodge, which is very far away from home, nestled in this giant hall in Birmingham. Now, Neve and her partner, Jake, are very into their American stuff. But when I met Neve, she was actually very much in love with her Morris Minor. Now, Neve, how did you go from a humble British classic to something beastly like this?
So when I met Jake, he was obviously into drag racing. So I went from going around English cars, you know, I had my Morris Minor, and then I met Jake, he was into hot rods, he was into drag racing. So then that sort of corrupted me and I've gone all this way. So
now there's a bit of a misconception, I think, that young people aren't into classic cars. From all the pictures I see that you upload of your days out at Dragstalgia and all the, is it Superstock?
Yes, Nostalgia Superstock.
Yeah, Nostalgia Superstock days. I see all these young people. What do you think the future of the classic car industry looks like with young people?
Yeah, so I see a lot of young people coming into it. I think, you know, it's going to have to go somewhere. And I think a lot of people are going to be inheriting cars as well. So I've got a car that I inherited. I think a lot of people are going to almost be forced into it, but I don't think it's going to die out anytime soon. You know, the amount of people that are our age, younger, a little bit older, that have got all of these cars, you know, I don't think it's going to die out. I think it might. We might see the scene changing a little bit as to more affordable cars that people are going to be able to get at a younger age. So,
now, despite this taking up an awful lot of garage room, you've got other stuff as well, haven't you? What have you got?
Yeah, so we've also got my 1926 Alvis 1250.
Impressive.
Yeah, that was my granddad's, so that's a pretty amazing car. And then we've also got my 1948 Austin Devon, which is another drag car. So that races in Gasser Circus. And then Jake's got this. And then we've got an American truck. And then we've got our dailies as well. So we've got quite a few.
Needless to say, they did actually build their own garage at home to be able to fit all this in.
Yeah.
Now, we talk a lot about skills, and we've been doing a lot with Kev in the garage at home with the NGC. Who is working on these cars?
So me and Jake work on most of our cars ourselves.
Great.
For things like race engines, we have someone build it. So we have a guy called Dave Billadoo who does all of our Mopar stuff. But things like, you know, basic servicing or just general stuff, tyre changes, we've got our own tyre machine and everything, we can do those sorts of stuff ourselves as well. So it depends on how big the job is. If it's a race motor, it's a bit different. So,
and what have you got planned next in your diary?
So this year we've got 6 events that we're racing at. So I'm going to race at 3, Jake and his dad are going to race at 3. So we've got 3 Superstock events, 3 Gasser Circus events. The first Superstock event is at the beginning of May, so that's our next one. So we're getting ready for that now. So,
brilliant. And I've got to ask, because I've always wondered, I've never actually asked you, where does the name Flag Jumper come from?
So there's a website called George Class Remembers, K-L-A-S-S, and it's got hundreds of photos of vintage drag car or classic drag cars on from the 60s, 70s. It's all filtered into sections. Jake just went on there one day, he was looking through photos, so we got the Jake Speed Equipment moniker on there and the Flag Jumper moniker on there, and then we just give it to our sign writer and we say, you go crazy, put what you want on it. So that's where it all came from.
Brilliant. Well, thank you so much for your time, Neve. We all wish you all the best for the season ahead.
Thank you.
Tim is quite an ambitious man, because at home he's got probably, would you say it's the crustiest of towel left?
It's probably the worst condition of towel there's been. Yeah, the last British Telecom estate.
That's pretty cool though.
Yeah, it's full of rust.
So you've got so much going on with that. Why have you taken on this? What is going on?
So this was a car that I was given for free. No
really?
Money, not a penny spent. The previous owner had plans to restore it one day and then got to the point where he sort of admitted defeat, contacted the owners club and said, I want someone to take it on, who's going to use it, not break it for parts, not bang a race it or anything like that. So a few of us contacted the club chairman, Chris Whedon, and said, yep, can you consider us? And it, Chris took the names to Richard, the owner, and said, these are the guys, this is how old they are, this is what they do, sort of thing.
Yeah.
And Richard said that he wanted me to take the car. So.
Oh, that's so nice.
Yeah. So picked it up. in September last year and bought it home and haven't done anything to it apart from change the oil and just wait for the NEC show. Mm. So we're having a go at recommissioning it and doing a first start hopefully later today.
So you are going to get this just recommissioned. What, for those of you at home that drive normal cars and live normal lives, you may not be fully acquainted with the nuances of recommissioning, because in my world that seems to have meant everything from a light service through to a crawling overhaul. So what is involved in recommissioning for this?
So for recommissioning, we've changed like perishable stuff, rubber bits, so cam belt, with these being an interference engine, if the cam belt breaks, things will come together and it'll make a mess. We're going to check brake systems and check lots of big deep services, essentially what we're doing. There's lots of parts we've got to fit. We'll be checking clearances, adjusting timing, things like that. And a sort of a lot of stuff to get it ready for an MOT. Once it's finished here, it's going to go for welding. I'm going to put it through an MOT and hopefully get it back on the road for the summer.
But you can weld, are you not doing the welding?
I will be doing the welding. I'll squeeze it in at some point as I've had enough practice on the Ital.
Fantastic. Now I hear from, do you know what, I saw a post only last night, people lamenting the loss of skills and saying young people aren't interested, young people don't have skills. Tom, your day job is not a mechanic. How did you build the skill set and the confidence to take a car like this and recommission it?
I think a lot of the skills and stuff come from, it comes from my dad and my like grandparents and things like that have all been engineers or that kind of thing. So, and I always like working with my hands and getting dirty. Things, I suppose the other thing is just learning. Like I really enjoy learning, if that makes sense. And looking at stuff online and watching TV shows, Wheeler Dealers and all that sort of stuff and thinking, I'd like to have a go at that, or, oh, that's how you can do that. And then, I mean, especially with like my metalwork and welding is a case of, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm going to have a try, and if it works, great. And if it doesn't work, I'll try again and watch a few more YouTube videos on how to do certain things. So
that's such a good outlook.
Yeah.
And for someone who hasn't ever picked up a set of tools, what advice would you give to them at home?
You sort of start with a basic socket set. Mm-hmm. Tinker with some, you know, it's a sort of stepping stone process. Start with an easier job, maybe just checking the timing, and then work up, you know, rebuild a carburetor. And then once you, you know, do these sort of stepping stones and things like that, you end up, you've almost gone through a car completely and you've rebuilt everything.
Nice one.
And some stuff, it seems really daunting, but if you read the Haynes manual and just take it slowly, take lots of photos, always take lots of photos, then you should be able to put it back together and it should fire straight off the key.
Some sound, solid, sensible advice for a man who never makes a sensible decision about any car.
Definitely not.
Well, good luck with this today. Hopefully we'll get to check in with you before we go home today and we'll be able to find out if you manage to get us started or not.
Hopefully. Fantastic.
Fingers crossed.
Nice one.
Goodness me. When you think of an A30, A35, these little everyday Austins, I don't think you're probably thinking of Roland. And I actually saw Roland online before we came to the show. And I spotted Sam posting about him. And I said, Sam, I have to come and find you at the show and chat to you about this car.
Yeah.
Sam, did Roland look like this when you found him?
He did slightly, but I've done a lot more work to him since. All the top of the roof rack, the interior, I made the headlining myself, all the door cards, etc. So I just keep adding all my own little quirks to him. So,
how often are you out in Roland? Is he your everyday driver?
He is during the summer.
Is he really?
He is, yeah. He gets parked in the car, works car park, and he gets spotted everywhere, but he does get parked up during the winter.
And what do people say when they see you out in Roland?
They just smile. And that's the whole point of him, just to put a smile on people's face. If I've done that, he's done his job. So.
I love that. Now, as someone who is into kind of that era of non-trendy older British classics, and I don't think they are. I think a Morris Minor is cool. I think an A30 is cool. But a lot of people tend to think it's the older generation into these cars. Now, I've seen a lot of younger people into the A30s and A35s. What brought you into the club, Sam?
So my parents have had these since I was 10. Mm-hmm. So I've just been brought up with them, and as soon as I could drive, I've owned one. So I've had three or four since I've been able to drive. So
brilliant. And Is Roland your only classic, or have you got any others?
No, these are my only classic. My dad, my parents have got four or five more, so we just swap and change.
That's fantastic. Now, I see that you're involved in your club as membership secretary.
Yep.
How do we get more young people not only involved in classics, but supporting the clubs that underpin that?
I think we just need to keep ourselves out there. We just need to get ourselves noticed and say they are not just for older people.
Yeah.
Anyone can own one, anyone can drive one.
Yeah. I love that. That's a really good ethos. So remember, if you are trying to push your club, that's what you need to be saying. Anyone can own one and anyone can drive one. And they're relatively easy to drive, aren't they?
Lovely to drive, definitely, yes.
And attracts a lot of attention. Well, that's it from us. Let's go and see what else we've got. I have been dragged here moderately against my will, but I do always like exploring the barn find sections. But Richard loves the Morris Minor. I mean, I get dragged to all these things, again, half willingly, because it is good fun. But Richard seems to know an awful lot about these cars, to say that he doesn't own them. And they have a very special connection. Richard, sum it up for us in 2 minutes, because otherwise we'll be here all day.
Definitely 2 minutes. It will be two minutes.
Tell us about these cars.
Fascinating, really, these cars. Both owned by my friend Martin. They're consecutive chassis numbers. You think how many Morris Minors were made over the years?
Yeah.
These two are literally one after the other on the line. So consecutive chassis numbers, both the same spec car, bought separately. They weren't, you know, one was bought before the other. I think PWL came first and then the Shell came later. The Martin had no idea. He didn't even enter his mind when he bought them. Consecutive chassis numbers, so it's really amazing to see literally two examples one after the next, especially for the Minor, as I say, because they say they made so many of them, you know, you wouldn't find that.
Did they make, Richard?
About 1.6 million over all the variants over all the years, sort of thing.
I think something that we talked about when we took your car, so you might remember, Richard, he's been in countless videos, but we drove the Morris Minor from Huddersfield down to Somerset,
and we talked
about export or die. Now, the idea behind export or die was that manufacturers were essentially told that they had to export. What was it? Was it 80 or 90%?
Oh, I think minimum 80%, but it was often above that, yeah.
Which meant that people in the UK would have been waiting years for a car. You essentially signed up for a waiting list, and then you would sit and you would wait and wait and wait. And so even at this point here, where these two were coming to market, it seems remarkable almost that two of these cars have not only ended
both
up
home market cars.
Yeah, home market.
Both have survived the 75 odd years.
Yeah.
It's incredible. Yeah,
survived,
yeah.
Home market, and they're here together today. Great coincidence, great story, and lovely to see them here today.
And the very last point as well.
Nope.
You got the Shell. This is a complete car. This car, we don't know the full story on this car, but this is an interesting car. It's an Oxfordshire Reg, as we know, Morris, Oxford company, Cowley. It's an ex-factory car. I really need to look deeply into this car and see if I can try and find anything that's not quite right, because I want to try and find something.
No.
But this car potentially had a very interesting start to life because it's got a factory Reg, so I need to do some digging on this one.
And while Richard does some digging, let's go and have a look at some other cars. Got some real nostalgia vibes with this Volvo, because this is what we had when I was a really small child before we moved on to the Jeep Cherokee. What's brought you back to Volvo life, Rich? Because, I mean, these are very... Sorry, I'm going to stop that. Hold on. Now, Volvos bring a real element of pure nostalgia for me, because this is what we had in this exact shade when I was a very small child. But we're now in 2024. Rich, what's brought you into Volvo lifestyle?
Well, I mean, why not? It's cool.
Yeah.
It's blue. It's built like a tank. And like you say, it's nostalgia. I remember back to my headmaster having one of these. He was a horrible man, but his car was cool. So why not?
Now, you're very handy with a set of spanners, because I know you help a certain Ms. Crabtree.
I do.
How easy is it to work on one of these?
It's really easy. I mean, it's very basic to work on.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, I mean, if you look around the side, we're actually fitting a new set of wheels this weekend.
Nice.
Which we've got off a 760 GLE.
Yeah.
I've had a bit of stick for it, 'cause it's a 200 series, and I'm putting 700 series wheels on it, which is a bit...
It's a
some people don't like it. Do I care? No. So...
The great thing about wheels is they're like shoes. You can just pop them off and pop another pair
exactly.
on. And the overall look is
yeah, exactly.
still retained. So.
Everyone's preference is different. So, you know,
and
what
how
I like
have you had
is,
this now?
I've had this 9 months.
Nine months.
It was a purchase that me and aforementioned Mrs. Crabtree decided would be a good purchase. And here it is.
And where did you find it?
We actually got it from London.
Did you?
Yeah, it was a police officer that lived in London.
Yeah.
That had it. Because of you, Les, he wanted rid. Mm. It's affectionately known as Luther.
Yeah.
Because of the police connection.
Nice.
And it's just a good old tank. It's just cool.
They are so good, so much fun, and so safe as well.
Yeah, exactly.
So safe.
Yeah.
Really great choice. Now, a lot of these get stolen quite frequently, don't they? What would you recommend to people with classics that are stolen quite a lot? Have you got any?
Well, this lives in my garage.
Yeah.
If you've got a garage, keep it in the garage. Your washing machines, they don't need to be in there. Your car's worth more, stick it in the garage. And I also swear by visual deterrence.
Yeah.
If you can see a steering lock,
yeah,
the thieves will go on to the next one.
Absolutely.
If it's got a tracker, they're going to take it. You'll get it back, but they're taking it.
And at what cost?
Yeah,
it'll be damaged.
So wheel locks, steering locks, even the old yellow gear stick locks, put one on it, you know.
Brilliant. Well, I think we're going to catch up with you later on in the year, aren't we?
Yep.
We're going to do a proper review on this car. We've just booked it in. Very exciting. So I guess we'll see you soon.
We'll see you soon.
There's nothing better than bumping into old friends at the Practical Classics Resto Show. And I've just bumped into Pete, who is working on this Citroen CX special. Now, this isn't something that you see every day in your local Tesco car park. And Pete's been very much instrumental in part of the build. So, Pete, what is going on with this?
It's a friend of mine, stroke secretary of the Citroen Car Club.
Yeah.
He's owned it since 1989, when he started building it. He eventually finished it in 94.
Yeah.
He used it for 7 or 8 years.
Yeah.
And then due to a company vehicle, we took it off the road. And it's been lapsing into a little bit of a state of disrepair, and afterwards he asked me to help recommission it.
So what's been involved in the recommissioning work?
He did a lot of the work himself.
Yeah.
He changed the engine, which was originally a Citroen CX 2.4 carburetor engine.
Yeah.
And
what is it now?
Now it is a CX 2.5 litre turbo.
Oh, okay.
So he did all the work himself, found a donor car.
Yeah.
We've updated the headlights to LEDs and everything. Got it running, gone through the suspension, all the hydraulics, because it's got hydraulic suspension. Basically just a full renovation.
And how much time has that taken you?
I've been doing it with him for the past year.
Really?
Maybe 2 years. Mainly on a Friday.
Yeah.
Just been recommissioning it. And as of yesterday, it was the first time it's been out of the garage.
Oh, really? And was it driven here?
It was driven onto a trailer.
Okay.
But when it came off the trailer, it drove in here on its own. So, but
fantastic.
There's still a few more little bits left to do, but most of it's 90% of it's done now. So
brilliant. So in terms of, we've talked about the engine, what gearbox have you got in it?
It's got the CX turbo gearbox.
Oh, okay, so they've been married up together.
Yeah,
then.
So they're all married together. It's got this, the CX Duravi steering, which self-centres itself, and under high pressure, but higher the speed you go, the heavier it gets. It's got CX turbo dashboard in it now.
Yeah.
We fitted reversing cameras.
Yeah.
We've updated it to the image wheels.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So
it looks good. It's a really interesting showstopper. Because as you walk around, there's a lot of cars that you've perhaps seen before. But something like this, you walk along and you think, wow.
Yeah.
And so I'd say it's probably one of the most memorable cars of the show. It's definitely a great addition to the stand. Thank you so much for letting us have a look around it and having a chat with you. And
yeah,
well done on all your hard work that's been part of it. You're very modest, but I know you've done quite a lot. So let's go and see what else we've got.
Thank you.
This seems like the perfect time to make the pun that I've had an excellent day at the Practical Classics Restoration Show. I've seen so many interesting cars, spoken to so many people that are both knowledgeable and just brimming with riveting stories about both their classics and all the things they've been doing in their workshops and garages at home. This is a brilliant show, and I guess my only regret is that because of mine and Fred's anniversary, I can only make one day this year. But just like everybody else that's streaming out around me, it's time for me to go home. Let me know in the comments section below which car has been your favourite today. And if you're wondering which was my favourite, it's definitely this crewmed car, which hit the spot perfectly. Now we'll be back again next time. Reviews, repairs and all the bits in between. But until then, take care and drive safely.